here we go. Our top eight. This is a top eight with a very, very storied history.
Oh, yeah.
We've done this top eight before. We did this top eight live at Grand Prix Las Vegas in 2015, and we lost the footage. The footage got corrupted, and so it's a legendary top eight, and I actually had the list sitting on my desk, so we thought we'd run it back with Luis live in studio, top eight vaults.
Yeah, so we had a running joke, which was that we were going to do top eight vaults.
Yes.
You know, from the vault vaults.
From the vault
but
vaults.
But it actually unintentionally became that.
Yep.
Because we recorded in Vegas, the footage got recorded over.
And in our high-tech Magic TV way, the way we had made this list is Luis spat it out, and I just wrote it on a like 400-count deck box. I just like was writing it out with a silver Sharpie, and I was going through the warehouse one day, and I was like, oh my gosh, there's that deck box. Grabbed it and had it sitting on my desk. So from that vault here to our top eight.
Yeah, those 20 different vaults, so it wasn't like, yeah, clear cut.
It's not clear. And there were even new vaults released since the inception of this, though they didn't make the cut. No spoilers.
Let's be clear. This is top eight vaults, which means it has to have vault in the title. So coming in at number... this is one. We're not going to pause for this, but take a moment if you're watching this on ChannelFireball.com. No searching. And just see how many of them you can get. If you're watching this right now live in the chat, see how many you can get, how many vaults you can name. You can name a few, and they're going to be the top half, but the bottom half's a little bit tough. All right. Number eight. Perilous vault.
So this might date the list a little bit because at the time of the list, this had just won a standard Grand Prix in blue black control.
Right.
Still, Perilous Vault is objectively powerful. It is a way to wipe the board.
The prominence of Perilous Vault at the PT is the only reason we could make this list because the other seven cards are like legit, like power level and like could see their way on a top eight list.
Yeah, I mean, like I would have put a different vault in there, but it would be my.
Oh, TBS has an honorable mention.
I do have honorable mention.
Okay, let's wind it back. TBS honorable mention.
Where's Mana Vault on this like top eight list?
Mana Vault is on the list. No spoilers here.
Oh no, it is there.
You got tricked.
I got tricked because
you
this list.
You got tricked.
I will say that there is an argument for Vault of the Archangels.
Yes,
but okay. I think Perilous Vault has seen a bit more of an impact. It actually made blue black control into a legit.
It was a legit thing, yeah. And I mean, again, this is a little bit more long, but at a Pro Tour, like this wasn't some random GP. So, coming in at number eight, Perilous Vault. We'll come back to TBS's honorable mention later on in the list. Coming in at number seven, Vault Scourge.
Vault Scourge is a mainstay in Affinity.
Definitely,
it has been ever since the printing of it. A one mana artifact with lifelink and evasion. Means that, it wears Cranial Plating and Arcbound Ravager counters very, very well.
Yeah. I mean, the evasion part is huge, right? Like, you can punch through if you need to.
Yeah. Also, in this, there's definitely some matchups where you need to have the lifelink. Like, against Burn, it's really, really good. Like, if you get one hit with the Vault Scourge in, you really just, like, undo a lot of the damage that the Burn decks and all the other aggressive decks do.
Yeah. Without quite, I mean, it's weird, though, how, like, the lifelink really does come into play.
It also matters in the mirror a lot, too.
Yeah.
Any kind of race, obviously, anytime you're racing, you want the lifelink when you're racing, so. Number six. Speaking of Finny. Vault of Whispers.
Deemed too powerful for Modern. I mean, this Vault of Whispers is an artifact land, so therefore it opens up for a lot of possibilities.
Could they ever, I mean, yes, and is it indeed, in your opinion, too powerful for Modern?
I actually don't think it is, but
TBS.
I think they can unban this.
You think they can walk back the artifact lands? And
think it would make Affinity really good.
But they wouldn't play all of them anyway.
No, they probably play
also,
the black and the blue ones.
What they should do is just unban Tree of Tales, the green one, and that's it. just for value.
That would be awful. Honestly, this is intriguing. Both of you agree that unbanning the artifact lands would not disrupt Modern.
Is this top eight vaults or top eight vaults we can unban?
This is top eight vaults. Vault of Whispers obviously was got banned in Block, legal and Standard, banned in Modern, right?
It was banned in Standard as well.
Yeah. Banned in Standard, banned everywhere, huh?
Yeah. I mean, the thing is, I think that Modern has gotten to a power level that you can, like adding more of these like artifact lands doesn't really change the clock for Modern that much. Does allow you to do some things you couldn't do, and it involves another card that's actually further down on this list. But I think overall, you could probably do that. Affinity would get better probably by like 10%, and maybe that would make a difference to the balance of
still
the
loses to the same cards. Loses even harder to Stony Silence, actually.
That's true.
But forget Robots as a deck. Forget the Affinity archetype.
Robots,
as a deck.
Excuse me?
Robots.
Robots is not a deck.
How about... No, but I'm just trying to like... segue away from that.
We'll forget Robots for sure. It's not even real to begin with.
Robots is a deck. Just trust me. Robots is a deck. What about the affinity mechanic if you have
The thing is, no one even plays a single affinity card anyway. Yeah. Maybe they play.
There's no artifact land.
No, but the thing is,
you're not playing Mirror Enforcer anyway. This isn't. It's not about that. Like, you play Thoughtcast. If you
Thoughtcast
already gets played in some decks, and it would get much, much better, sure. But it's really just about Cranial Plating and Rabidear. Yeah.
Mm. I mean, you might, like, there might be a version that's like the Frogmite Enforcer deck. That might exist as a deck with these. But that doesn't, it's not that much better. I mean, you have, more, evasive threats with the current build of the deck, and I think that might be better overall.
Interesting. We're going to revisit this. This top eight is not time for this, but we will revisit this on Magic TV because I'm super interested in this. Coming in number five, old school players like old school cards. Lim Duel's Vault.
All right, so who of us knows the actual text of Lim Duel's
Vault? Oh, I know.
I don't know if I get it. It's one black, one blue. I don't want to look. It's one black, one blue.
Yes.
Instant. Do you mill 10?
Oh. You don't mill anything.
No milling.
You reveal cards from the top of your deck.
No.
All right, go for it.
You look at the top five of your deck.
Yes.
You can put them in any order or pay one life. And if you pay one life, you put those at the bottom of the deck in any order, and then you do the next five.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You keep on going until you want to stop.
I don't know why we use the new picture of Lim Duel's Vault. That's
Armando,
disrespectful.
You have one job, Armando.
No, he has like seven jobs, to be fair. But
no,
in this case,
we've had this argument many, many times. Armando always insists on the new art.
It's not the new art, it's the better one.
Right. See, anyway, Lim Duel's Vault is a broken card. Yes. I remember, when I first played with this card, it was to find your Sarah Angel. Not a good idea. I was very bad back then. Right now, Lim Duel's Vault would be
absurd. It's like a third color. It's like one black, one blue to find your
white creature. It's to find a Singer Vampire then. but still, this card is actually busted. It's a tutor. For like five life, you get to see 25 cards.
Unbelievable.
And you get to put them in any order. So it is a really busted card. It's certainly one of the top eight vaults. And it's a card that was pretty excruciating to play against. It just took your opponent forever. They'd just be like...
Yeah, it is awful. Yeah, and you sit there like, do I want to pay one more? What's your? And then you finally, okay, what's the order I'm going to do it in? But Lim Duel's Vault, too good for modern?
Yeah. Can you imagine this in Death Shadow? You get to pay X life. You can just go ahead and just go.
clearly too good for modern.
With the sound effect. Yeah.
Of course. It doesn't work if you don't have the sound
effect. That's clear.
Number four, it is funny. You don't realize how tied in vaults are to Affinity. So you do a top eight vault. So it's coming in at number four, Disciple of the Vault.
Yeah, speaking of vaults that make someone lose life.
Speaking of...
This is the card that I think that may make unbanning all the
artifact lands
maybe a little tough, because this was the reason why you could kill someone from really quickly.
Yeah. I don't even know if this would see play even if the artifact lands got unbanned. That said, I have to give historical relevance, points to it, because it was banned in Block and Standard.
Yeah,
but it was ridiculous because you out of nowhere you could just win a game, right?
Yeah, no, I mean, part of the reason was that you only had to sacrifice half as many artifacts as you normally would have to Ravager to kill your opponent. That's kind of like the combo,
right? Ravager, and for each artifact you're sacking your Ravager to build it up, of course, you get to not drain, but cause your opponent to lose one life, and of course we have multiple disciples. Good God, that's when things really got out.
Well, also, do you remember if they had a disciple and you're a disciple, that the way you did it is on their turn you sacked an artifact, both triggers went in the stack, you let yours resolve, theirs was still in the sack, you sacked another artifact, both triggers went, not good.
And these are the things about playing Magic.
If you want to know what is good skill testing Magic, I actually don't think that's it. That's like, do you know the tax code? And that's not a very strategically interesting, it's just more straight up tax.
That's like up there with, remember when it was Demigod, effect on the stack, God, come on, I don't want to do that, so, but nevertheless, a very powerful card, a very powerful vault card. Number three, timely, as we look ahead to 2018, Mutavault.
Why is it timely?
It's the GP promo.
Ah, well, there we go.
Is this not public information?
It is public
information. Okay,
he just doesn't know this.
Okay, I think he's wait a minute. We've already published that.
Dragged off the stage. Well, it's a kind of loose definition of vault, but we'll take Muta Vault.
Oh, what are you calling it? The art clearly is a vault.
That's true. Like, it is more vault-like than Disciple of the Vault.
Yeah, no, it's a vault.
Yeah.
It literally says vault.
Muta Vault. It's a vault of whatever you want it to be, right?
That's any kind of vault.
That's any kind of vault.
This card, I think, actually single-handedly ruined Standard for about 2 years. But
oh my gosh!
Well, in Theros Block, you had to play mono blue or mono black because Mutavault was so powerful. It made mono color the best deck by far. That said, it's because it's so powerful. It is a great card.
Yeah.
Seeing playing what, like Modern Merfolk right now, yeah, who knows what else exactly, but it is a good card.
And its time and Standard both times saw just rampant play, right? When it was originally printed.
Oh, yeah, fairies. It was a Spellstunner Sprite.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, this is really
that was
really
sweet, though.
I mean, the fact that it fits in so many different tribal decks is mm-hmm. one of the reasons it was great. But even, as you said, in the Standard that didn't actually have that much tribal, it was still good as a creature land.
Yeah, just 1 minute, 2/2. Sometimes it was a pack rat, though.
Yeah, that's true, it was a pack rat.
Yeah. All right, coming in at number two, TBS, what is our number two vault on this list?
It's Mana Vault, and the reason why I didn't think there was Mana Vault, because it's actually misprinted on our list over here, but Mana Vault, 1 mana artifact, and it basically taps for 3, and you can untap it during the upkeep step for 4 if you have to.
And if you don't, it gets you one during your draw step.
So let's be clear about this. For 1 colorless mana, you get access to 3 mana. Now, the drawback is the artifact doesn't untap unless you put 4 mana into it or lose a life. 1 life. Yeah.
Anyway, it's a 1 mana artifact that taps for 3. It's,
it's unbelievable.
It is rightfully restricted in Vintage, Abandoned, Legacy.
Yeah.
And just mana accelerants of this caliber really don't have a place in the modern game or the legacy game, really.
Yeah.
it's kind of funny that Alpha somehow needed Soaring and Mana Vault and Black Lotus, but who knows?
it is weird. Anytime you have retrospectives about the origins for Magic, you start to realize how power levels just weren't understood, right?
That said, Alpha's a masterpiece. I think it was one of the best design sets of Magic, entirely.
Really?
Yeah, that's a topic for a different day, but I think Alpha, I can go on and on about how Alpha's a legit masterpiece. You'd be interested in subscribing. You love anything Magic before 1996, but...
I agree. I think if they didn't do certain things in Alpha correctly, we don't have Magic.
TBS and I are both certified professional game designers.
We should. You know what we should have done?
Well, actually, Ari, you're not employed
I'm freelancing.
He's freelancing.
Self-employed, whatever.
TBS probably just retired. TBS.
This all the Bitcoin.
Or Mistress Bob. We should have done top 8 design sets. And now I so regret the fact that having both of you in studio, we didn't do that. So another time, when the two of you are together, we've got to do top 8 designed Magic.
Sure.
I think that would be
Alpha would be on the list with a bullet.
Yeah, no, absolutely. It's possible that it would be number one, but it's really close to the top.
All right, wow.
There's a lot of reasons. This is a good future MTV. Also, I want to shout out Tommy Adams, who just subscribed to our channel with Twitch Prime.
Is Tommy really watching?
I sure hope so.
Oh my God. Welcome, Tommy. All right, Armando, you got to get this down somewhere. We got to do top 8 designed Magic sets. We'll do it with Luis and a TBS. If we get Raptor or something like that, that'd be even better. Okay, that leaves us with 1 last vault in our top 8 vaults. This number one card, 2 years in the making, just to get to this card.
I know. It feels like it's almost the end of an era once you do top 8 vaults. Like,
it was such a great joke.
Am I even supposed to come back on the show?
This is your swan.
This is the peak. I can just take off the mic.
Farewell, Luis. This has been a running joke for ages.
Literally like 6 years, 7 years.
Yeah, no.
Since they did From the Vault, probably.
Was it From the, yeah. We started it, we did the actual list.
Right.
From the Vault, yeah, top 8 vaults. Okay, coming in at number one, no surprise here, not a huge mystery.
Mana Tithe?
We've already done number two, Armando. Are we clear on this?
Yeah.
Okay. Coming in at number 1, Time Vault.
The new picture of Time Vault. This is killing me.
This is how Armando does things. You know what? I'm going to take a moment to thank you, Luis. This is a rare thing. Finally, someone that Armando might listen to. Luis Scott Vargas.
Oh, he knows I'm only in town for a week.
He's not here. He's old art, but he actually respects you. He doesn't respect the rest of us.
I've never seen this art before.
Where is this from? Is this like the Moto?
VMA?
Oh, VMA?
It's not even a real card.
Well, in any case, Time Vault is literally too good for Vintage Cube. I believe it was too good for Vintage Cube. And this is a collection of cards like Black Lotus and Sol Ring. Because if you combine Time Vault with any untap effect, Voltaic Key is the most common, Tezzeret the Seeker.
Is Key still in the Vintage Cube?
No, because without the Vault, doesn't do much. Totally Tezzeret the Seeker is still in, but like Tezzeret the Seeker, Key are the two biggest ones. Mm-hmm. But you even have random stuff like Deceiver, Exarch, or Pestermite.
Right.
And it gives you infinite turns in the case of Key and Tezzeret, extra turns in the case of like Pestermite. And for 2 mana, that's just too much.
It's the Time Vault's a funny card. Did you ever play with Time Vault when it was originally out? Like,
oh yeah, because you couldn't actually do all of these tricks originally.
Yeah.
No, because there was a time counter.
Yes.
Right.
You had to skip a turn and put a time counter on.
I mean, at one point the Oracle text was like, you must skip a turn to untap it. The only way to untap this card was to skip a turn. Period. Forget trying to get around it.
Oh yeah, Ral's Eric is another one tap points.
Yeah. But the funny thing is, I think as good as design set Alpha is, I think this is actually probably the biggest mistake they did in Alpha.
You think that's the biggest mistake?
When it comes to like power level cards, I actually think this card is problematic.
I disagree with you there. Me and TBS really need to settle down for an hour long talk about Alpha.
I don't mean it's the most powerful card. I just mean it's like the, I don't know.
You're really that worried about instill energy and animate artifact?
Oh my god.
Yeah, instill energy. Right.
I mean,
I did that back in the day.
That worked for a little while.
A lot of people did.
I mean, Stasis was also not great, but.
I love Stasis. I love the art on Stasis.
Did Armageddon increase net fun? I mean.
No, I think Armageddon definitely increased net fun.
Life Force, Death Grip.
What about something like Rock of Care Ridges versus Hill Giant? That was always the big
one. No, that was actually really good. That was good. We can explain why it was good.
Okay.
In our unreleased Alpha segment.
Different see, now that we've jettisoned Vaults, now we've
obviously, all TBS and I want to do is talk about Alpha.
Alpha is like the best set.
We'll do it. I promise you all, this is the problem. We will do it. I will say this.
What's going to actually happen is we're just going to do a podcast about it. Because we're not going to wait until we get back to it.
I would love to listen to it. I'd listen to the heartbeat.
Oh, Lotus was not a mistake. Lotus is genius.
Lotus.
Ancestral Recall, Soaring. Mm.
So, yeah. I will say this. I did Mark Tiedin did the original art, which you can't see here, so this story isn't going to make as much as Mark Tiedin did the original art for Time Vault. And if you look at it, there's a guy there who's got like a hammer and tongs. He's wearing this blue and red robe. If you then look at the art for Time Twister, you can see this gnarly hand pointing, and you can see that same blue and red robe.
Oh, I didn't know that.
And I went to Mark. I was like, this is crazy. I've always, like, what were you thinking? Was it like a backstory they gave you? You know, is this the same character? Like, what's going on here? I've always imagined, like, this evil wizard, like, tinkering and playing with time and stuff. And he looks at me and goes, I never noticed I did that.
No.
Totally.
Like, did you ever do the thing where you put Guardian Angel and Paralyze next to each other, and like it just Anthematics just goes right down, and it's just like this amazing.
Yeah, that's.
And then you take the Mark Tiedin, and he's just like, what?
He's like, oh, I didn't notice I did that. I'm like, and if you see Mark, Mark Tiedin's one of the greatest artists you can interact with at a GP. He's so fun. He's so into it. Definitely hit him up. And it was just like he's kind of a goofy guy. He's like, oh yeah, I didn't notice that. And I was like.
No.
Years! You had this whole backstory of like this evil wizard that was doing this. It turns out, Mark just had a lot of red and blue paint hanging around.
So. Yeah.
Check it out. All right. That's our top eight vaults. Now all we can do is talk about some mythical top eight set designs for Magic.
Ooh.
We'll wait another 8 years for that. Okay. Two more top eights left.